إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم. أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. It is the 29th night of the month of Dhul-Hijjah, 1437 years after the migration, the Hijrah of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which we consider the night of Saturday, Yawm al-Sabt. This is Laylatul Sabt, corresponding with the 30th day, Friday of September 2016. And the class that we've been dealing with is a lecture, a muhadara, from the noble scholar Al-Allama, a Sheikh Saleh ibn Abd al-Aziz al-Sheikh, Habibullah. And the name of this lecture is Huquq al-Ukhuwa. Huquq al-Ukhuwa, the rights of brotherhood. We left off with some mazahir, indications or manifestations of this particular right. And the right, the manifestation that we left off with is al-Mazhar al-Thalith من مظاهر حفظ العرض أن تحفظ أسراره, is that you protect and guard your brother's reputation and honor by guarding his secrets. By guarding his secrets. The Sheikh says, وأسراره هي التي بثها إليك. بث إليك نظرا له. بث إليك رأيا رآه في مسألة تكلمتم في فلان فقال لك رأيا له في فلان, تكلمتم في مسألة فله رأي فيها بثه إليك لأنك من خاصته. The Sheikh, he says that he has secrets of which he has disclosed to you. She has some private matters that she has revealed to you, the brother to the brother, the sister to the sister. The Sheikh says, and this is with respect to you, regarding you. The reason why the Sheikh is saying that the person is telling you this, because they consider you a bosom buddy. They consider you a close friend. They consider you a confidant. They consider you a confidant. They consider you a khalil, a very close friend. Because as we mentioned sometimes before, in one of the talks a couple of weeks ago, that a khalil is closer than a sadiq. So when you have khulla, that's extremely close. So the person is letting you know something about their asrar. And once again, we want to build up a vocabulary. A sir in Arabic, seen with a kasra, and then ra with the shadda, sirrun, sirrun, and the plural is asrar, aleph, hamza, fatha, seen, sukun, s, then ra, with an aleph, asrar, and then ra, asrarun. Asrar is the plural word of sir. Sir is a secret, that's a secret. So the person has asrar, that they disclose to you, because they trust you. You are their brother in Islam. You are their sister in Islam. And you are their friend. You have a special, close relationship with them. So, in light of how they respect you, and how they view you, and how they honor you, because to tell you a secret, that shows that's honor. If they tell you a secret, that means they're honoring you, because they're telling you something private that they won't disclose to anybody and everybody. So that within itself is a tazkiyah for you. That's a tazkiyah for you. They are honoring you. They're showing you that you have some sharf. You have some sharf. You have some nobility with them. So the Sheikh, he says, so he discloses to you, or she discloses to you, some of their opinions, some of their views, right? Those views or their opinions may be on any subject. Their views or their opinions may be on the United States of American government, the Congress or the Senate. It may be the view that they have about a sister that sells clothes. It may be a view that you have, a personal view that you have that you don't want to disclose to anybody, that you may think that, you know, some of the ulama are wrong in some of the decisions and the fatwas that they make. It may be anything that you don't want the average person knowing about it. You don't want them to know. You may tell them something that you've been afflicted with some disease, a fatal disease or a not-so-fatal disease, a temporary disease. But nonetheless, it's something that is a sirr. It's a secret. So they tell you this either because maybe they want to get your advice or otherwise, whatever reason. Or they just love you. They're just so close to you. They just want to share things with you. It may be something good. It may be something bad. So the sheikh says that تَكَلَّمْتُمْ فِي فُلَانٍ. You may be talking about someone. You may be talking about someone amongst yourselves. So he'll tell you your opinion about them. What this specific mas'ala, this subject that you're talking about, this matter. He says, so he spreads it to you because you are from his khawas. You are khasatihi, min khasatihi, right? He says, وَلِأَنَّكَ مِنْ أَصْحَابِهِ, because you're from his companions. You, sister, you're that sister, sahabiyya. You're her close sahabiyya, her companion. He says, رُبَّمَا يُخْطِئُ وَرُبَّمَا يُصِيبُ. Perhaps your friend that's giving you this information, this secret, this sir, this secret, perhaps they may be wrong, perhaps they may be right. Perhaps they may be making a mistake, or perhaps they may have hit the target, bullseye, incorrect. فَإِذَا كُنْتَ أَخًا صَادِقًا لَهُ أَوْ لَهَا. If you are truly a brother to him, فَإِنَّمَا بَثَ إِلَيْكَ ذَلِكَ لِتَحْفَظَهُ لَا لِأَنْ تُشِيعَهُ لِأَنَّ مُقْتَضَى لَأُخُوَّةِ الْخَاصِ أَنْ يَكُونَ مَا بَيْنَ الْأَحْبَابِ سِرٌّ. The Shaykh, he says, the Shaykh Salih, the Shaykh حَفِظُهُ اللَّهِ, he says, so he's spreading these things to you. He's disclosing these things to you. She's revealing these things to you so that you will protect it. You will preserve it. Like, for instance, you put your money in a box. You go to Target or whatever place you go to, and you get one of those nice, strong boxes. Or you maybe even take it even a step higher. You get a safe. You get a safe with a combination that's real thick. You can't even lift it. It takes 2, 3, 4 men to lift it up because you want to put your money in there. You want to put your Social Security cards in there. You want to put your passports in there or your green card or whatever it is that you want to preserve. How much more preserving the irud, the honor and the reputation of your brother, and part of that is his asrar, is his or her secrets. So he's telling you this to keep it. He's telling you this to keep it. Like, for instance, I told some brothers, some of you brothers, you've been knowing me for years. Some of you brothers have been knowing me for like 15 years, 20 years. Some of you brothers, 25 years. They're sitting here right now. I, for the brothers who know, back, well, you don't know this part, but you know up until this part. I have been functioning as an imam and a teacher of Islam for almost 40 years. Almost 40 years. And 22 of those 40 years, I used to do marital counseling. I used to counsel the Muslims when they had their marriage problems. In July of 2003, I stopped doing it for different reasons. Some people spread out there that it's for other reasons, but it's for reasons that are my personal business. One of them is that it just stresses you out. It's just a stress. It's very, very stressful. But the point I want to make is that I have counseled people from Iraq, people from Palestine, people from Yemen, people from Turkey, people from Iran, people from Yemen, Trinidad, Tobago, Japan, Ireland, Australia, Germany, Italy, because Allah blessed me to go to 23 countries in my da'wah. 23 countries. So every place I used to go, somebody used to always pull me to the side and want me to either counsel them in their marriage or counsel them because they had an issue with their parents. The young brother wants to get married. His parents want him to get a bachelor's degree. Then when he finishes the bachelor's degree, they want him to get a master's degree. And when he finishes the master's degree, they want him to get a PhD. And he's telling them, it's a fitna. I'm going to college. I have to go. I'm around all these naked ladies. May Allah protect us. I need to get married. And say, well, come to me and ask me questions. The point that I want to make is that I have 22 years of private information about people. And I told some brothers, I know that some Muslims, they can't wait till I die. Because if I die, then all that stuff is going to be in the ground with me. Nobody will know. 22 years of deep, dark secrets. Private, seriously private information about Muslims and their private lives. The brothers and the sisters, the husbands and the wives. So these are things that we do to because we trust someone. When we trust someone, we will let them know things about people or our personal lives that we may not let anybody else know. So the Sheikh says, he's telling you this so that لِتَحْفَظَهُ لَا لِأَن تُشِيعَهُ. He's telling you that to preserve these things, not to spread them. He's not telling you to spread them. He said, because الْأُخُوَّةُ الْخَاصَّةُ, that special, specific, unique, intimate brotherhood necessitates أَنْ يَكُونَ مَا بَيْنَ الْأَحْبَابِ سِرٌ. That it necessitates. There's no way you can get around it. That when you become close to somebody, you're going to tell them some private things, some secrets. If they're real close to you. As we mentioned last week, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran and Surah Nur about people who you give the keys to your house. That's how close a person can become. You give him the mafatih. You may give him the keys to your house. You may give him the keys to your car, etc. I told some brothers some years ago, there are brothers that were so close to me, I would trust them with my family and $1 billion. I would trust them with my family and $1 billion. And I know if I came back 5 years later, then my family's going, they won't hurt them, they won't harm them, they watch after them, and nobody, and they won't touch one penny of that $1 billion. That's how much I trusted them. That's how much I believed that they were honorable and they were close to me. So the Sheikh says, so that this special brotherhood is that you have, it's going to be inevitable that there's going to be a sir, a secret between you and him. كما جاء في الحديث الذي رواه أبو داود الإمام أبو داود في سننه رحمه الله تعالى الرجل, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إذا حدث الرجل بحديث ثم التفت عنه فهي أمانة. He says, if a man is talking to another man, if a sister, a woman is talking to another sister, they're having a conversation in their SUV, they're having a conversation in the library, they're having a conversation in Dunkin' Donuts, they're having a conversation in the masjid, they're sitting on the bench in a park. Once you have a conversation with someone, the Sheikh is saying from the hadith of the Prophet collected by Imam Abu Dawood, rahimahullah, and others, in his sunan, that once they have a conversation with you and then they depart, he turns away from that brother, then what was said was an amana. It is a trust. What was said was an amana. He said, Wallahu jalla wa ala amarana bihifz al amanat. And Allah, the mighty, the sublime, has ordered us to keep and preserve our trust. Wa hifz al a'rad, wa hifz al a'rad. And the preservation of reputation and honor in a person's name, he says, is a part of that. لِأَنَّكَ إِذَا ذَكَرْتَ هَذَا الرَّأِي مِنْهُ فَإِنَّ النَّاسَ يَقَعُونَ فِيهِ. He said, تَرَى مِنْهُمْ, the Sheikh says, تَرَى مِنْهُمْ رَأْيًا عَجِيبًا. The Sheikh says that because when you mentioned his opinion that he has from him, then the people, they're going to fall into these things. It's going to occur that the people, if you tell people, then they're going to know. They're going to, it's going to drive them into something. It's going to push them into something. And you will see, and then the people will start saying, he has some strange ideas. He has some strange concepts because you revealed it. You know, it reminds me of a poem that says, do not disclose your secret except to yourself. Do not expose your secret except to yourself. For every confident has a confident. You understand, brothers? For every confident has a confident. I'm not pronouncing confidant. That's the way we should pronounce it. Don't say confident. Confidant. A confidant is someone who you confide in and tell your secrets. In other words, once it comes from your mouth, is no longer a secret. How many of us say this to our brother? Between me and you, right? Baini wa bainak. No, once you say between me and you, it's no longer between me and you. No matter how loyal that person is, how trusted that person is. There's a statement I have from one of the people of the past, Al-Jahiz, rahimahullah. He says, when a secret has gone between the breast of its owner and escaped from his tongue to a single ear, by that time it is no longer a secret. The breast of the second ear's owner is narrower, is more restricted, and he is quicker to disclose it, more cavalier with it, and more excusable in speaking of it. And any case against him is going to be invalid. Any case against him is going to be invalid. He said, this is so even if the speaker is held to an oath committed to keeping the secret and is an intelligent, disciplined, and sincere friend. Because the best thing to do, it's not necessary that you keep all your secrets to yourself, because, you know, sometimes you need to tell some things to get advice or whatever. But the best thing to do is to keep it to yourself. So the sheikh, he says, so if you expose that, then the people are going to think about your brother that told you that information, that he has some strange ideas. He has some strange opinions. تَقُولُ فُلَانْ يَرَى هَذَا الرَّأِي. Then you're going to say that this brother, he has some opinions about some things. It's kind of strange. فُلَانْ يَقُولْ فِي فُلَانْ كَذَا. Or he said this about that person. That person, he said this about that person. So the sheikh, he says, مَا مَعْنَى الْأُخُوَّةِ. What is the meaning of brotherhood? He said, هَلْ تُشِيعُ عَنْهُ مَا يَرْغَبُ أَنْ يُشَاعَ عَنْهُ. Is brotherhood that he would desire for you to disclose what you're disclosing? Is that brotherhood? That's what the sheikh is asking. He says, بَلْ أَعْظَمُ مِنْ ذَلِكَ أَنْ يَتْفِي أَخٌ بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَ أَخِيهِ عَقْدٌ أُخُوَّةٌ خَاصَةٌ فَيَسْتَكْتَمِعُ عَلَى حَدِيثٍ فَيَقُولُ هَذَا الْحَدِيثُ خَاصٌ بِكَ لَا تُخْبِرُ بِهِ أَحَدًا. He said, so if that's the case, then greater than that, is that there's something between him and his brother and himself that's a special type of contract, a special type of brotherhood that you have. He said, and then he discloses something to you, he reveals something to you, and then he says, this is between me and you, don't tell anybody. Because the hadith that he mentioned from Imam Abu Dawood just means in general. Once we have a conversation with each other, I don't have to say to you, don't tell anybody. I'm not supposed to tell you, don't tell anybody. But if I tell you, don't tell anybody, the sheikh says, that's a'azam. That's even greater, because now I've told you, don't tell anybody. For you to go out, you cause all kinds of problems, and that's a violation, that's a breach. That is khiyana. That is khiyana. That is a treachery. It's a violation of trust. So the sheikh says, فَيَأْتِي هَذَا الثَّانِي وَيُخْبِرُ ثَالِثًا. So you told one person, that's a second person, what the brother over here told you in private. That second person tells a third person. That third person tells a fourth person. That fourth person tells a fifth person. He says, هَذَا خَاصْ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَكَ لَا تُخْبِرُ أَحَدًا. It's between me and you, don't tell anyone. ثُمَّ يَنْتَشِرُ فِي الْمُجْتَمِعِ وَالْأَوَّلُ غَافِلٌ عَنْهُ. And then it spreads in the community while the person who told you is totally unaware. He doesn't even know what's going on. So the sheikh says, فَهَذَا وَاقِعَ. He said, this actually happens. And the sheikh doesn't have to tell us this one. We know that this happens. We know that it happens. فَإِنَّ الْمَرَى إِذَا اصْطَفَى آخَرَ. He says, because when a person chooses another, إِذَا اصْطَفَى صَاحِبًا لَهُ, if he chooses a companion for himself, أَخًا لَهُ فَأَخْبَرَهُ بِسِرٍ فَلَا بُدَّ مِنَ الْكِتْمَانِ. He says, and if he informs him of something, he apprises him of a sirr. A sirr is what? A secret. I'm trying to remember. See if you brothers remember these vocabulary words, right? If he informs you of a secret, فَلَا بُدَّ مِنَ الْكِتْمَانِ, then it is inevitable. You have to keep it a secret. خَاصَةً إِذَا اسْتَأْمَنَهُ عَلَيْهِ. فَإِذَا لَمْ يَسْتَأْمِنْهُ عَلَيْهِ فكما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا حدث الرجل الرجل بحديث ثم التفت عنه فهي أمانة. He says, if he gives you some information that is a secret, then it is incumbent upon you to be quiet, especially if he has made it a trust. He's made it a trust. Do not tell anyone. Do not tell anyone. He says, so then, if that person didn't give you the trust, meaning didn't say, don't tell anyone and make it a trust and say, this is a trust between me and you, then you still have to keep it that way, even if they don't say that to you. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when two people are speaking, then when they turn away from each other, or when he turns away from him, then it is an amana. فَكَيْفَ إِذَا اسْتَكْتَمَهُ إِيَّهُ وَلَمْ يَأْذَنْ لَهُ بِذِكْرِهِ. He says, so how much more if he asked him to be quiet with it and be silent, and he didn't give him permission to mention it. He says, مِنْ مَظَاهِرِ حِفْظِ الْعِرُدِ أن يحجم المرء عن ذكر المساوي التي رآها في أخيه. And this is something we mentioned in brief last week. Also from the manifestations, the indications of protecting the honor and the reputation of your sisters, and your brothers, is that the person muzzles himself. He puts a muzzle over his mouth, zips it up, as we say here in America, he puts a zip on mentioning the bad characteristics or defects or qualities about what he sees in his brother. أو في أهله, or what he sees in his family. أو في قرابته, or what he sees in his relatives. أو في ما سمع منه, or what he hears from him. مثلا, واحد يتصل بأخيه فيسمع وهذا ساكن مثلا مع أهله أو منفرد فيسمع في بيته ما لا يرضي فيذهب ويخبر يقول سمعت في بيت فلان كذا وكذا وكذا. He says, for instance, as we said last week, the person, he may hear something, for instance, so when he contacts his brother, for instance, he contacts his brother by phone, for instance, or he comes to his house and he hears something, as we mentioned last week, in the background. He hears somebody using some bad language or whatever it is. He hears something that his wife is saying in the background or what his family is saying in the background. Then after he hears that, he says, I heard such and such, and I heard such and such, and I heard this comes from so and so. He says, أو يراه على حال ليست بمحمودة. Or he sees him in a situation that's not a praiseworthy situation. He sees him in a situation which is not a praiseworthy situation. فيذهب يخبر بمساويه. Then he goes and he starts spreading the brother's faults. She starts disclosing the sister's defects. ليس هذا من حفظ العرض. This is not from the preservation of the honor and the reputation. بل هذا من انتهاك العرض. But rather, this is the destroying and breaking down and decimating the honor and the reputation. He says, وَالْوَاجِبْ عَلَيْكَ أَن تَحْفَظَ عِرُضَ أَخِيكَ. He says, it is obligatory on you. This is not an option. It's obligatory on you to preserve your brother's and sister's honor. وَإِذَا سَمِعْتَ شَيْئًا عَنْهُ أَوْ رَأَيْتَهُ هُوَ عَلَى حَالٍ أَوْ تُكَلَّمًا بِمِقَالٍ أَوْ رَأَيْتَهُ عَلَى شَيْءٍ لَنْ يُحْمَدْ أَوْ نَحْوَ ذَلِكَ. He says, so if you hear anything from him, meaning something from him that is not correct, it's not nice, it's not Islamic, you see in him something, or you catch him in a situation, you're coming from work, you just got off work, 12 o'clock in the morning, and you see him standing outside, 12:30 in the morning, talking to somebody that you know, that, and you reveal it. Or you hear him saying something that's improper. Or you see him do anything that would never be praiseworthy or the like. Then you have to preserve your brother's honor. It is obligatory. He says, لا أن تبذل عرضه. You can't disclose or damage his reputation. He says, وأن تتكلم فيه. Or to talk about him. You can't talk about him. He says, لِأَنَّ الْعِرْضِ مَأْمُورْ أَنْتَ بِحِفْظِهِ. He says, because his reputation and his honor, you have been ordered, commanded, you and I, to preserve it. He says, وَكُلُّ الْمُسْلِمْ عَلَى الْمُسْلِمْ حَرَامْ دَمُهُ وَمَالُهُ وَعِرُضُهُ. Because for every single Muslim, his blood, his property, and his reputation and name and honor are haram. مَسْأَلَةٌ نَصِيحَةٌ تَتِّي إِنْشَاءَ. Then the Shaykh says, and the matter of advice is going to come, inshallah. He says, it's going to come بِحَقٍ خَاصٍ, with a specific mentioning of a specific right. It's going to come with nasiha. He says, فِي مَا يَكُونُ بَيْنَ الْإِخْوَانِ مَعَ التَّنَاصُحِ. Then the Shaykh, he says, قَدْ قَالَ عَلَيْهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ لَا تَحَسَّسُوا وَلَا تَجَسَّسُوا وَلَا تَقَاطَعُوا وَلَا تَدَابَرُوا وَكُونُوا عِبَادَ اللَّهِ إِخْوَانًا. The Shaykh, he said that the Messenger of Allah, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, said, do not nurse enmity. Do not spy on one another. Do not have estranged relationships with one another. Be Allah's slaves, brothers to one another. وَلَا تَجَسَّسُوا. He said, وَلَا تَحَسَّسُوا وَلَا تَجَسَّسُوا. Then the Shaykh, he says, لَقَدْ اشْتَمَلَ عَلَى كَلِمَتَيْنِ. There's two words here, comprised, two words. وَهُوْ قَوْلُهُ عَلَيْهِ صَلَّى السَّلَامِ فِي هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ الْمُتَّفِقُ عَلَى صِحَّتِهِ لَا تَحَسَّسُوا وَلَا تَجَسَّسُوا. There is, the Shaykh is saying, in this hadith, that it is agreed upon with its soundness and correctness and authenticity is agreed upon, where the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam tasleem al mazida said, la tahassasu wa la tajassasu. He says, al-farqu bayna tahassusi wa tajassusi kama qala ta'ibatun min ahli al-ilm wa thamma khilaf bayna dhalik. He says, qalu at-tajassusu yakunu bil-'ayn وَالتَّحَسُّسُ يَكُونُ بِالْأَخْبَارِ. The Shaykh says that the scholars, some of the scholars or group of the scholars, they say that there's a difference between, or they say that there's a difference between the word التَّجَسُّس with a jim, and the other one, you take away the dot from the jim, التَّحَسُّس. So التَّجَسُّس and تَحَسُّس. التَّجَسُّس is with the eye. التَّحَسُّس, and there's some differences amongst the scholars, but in general, التحسس means being informed or informing. He says, دليل ذلك قوله جل وعلا يا بني يذهبوا فتحسسوا من يوسف وأخيه ولا تيأسوا من روح الله. The interpretation of the meaning of this ayah, which we hope, inshallah, is the 87th ayah of the Quran in Surah Yusuf. We hope, because it could be 86, could be 88, 87, inshallah, of Surah Yusuf. The interpretation of the meaning of this, Ya Bani Yadhabu, O my sons, go out, go forth, فَتَحَسَّسُوا مِنْ يُوسُفَ وَأَخِيهِ. Go out, find out about Yusuf. And just as a side note, brothers, sometimes we make the mistake and we say Yusuf. This is a side note. We say Yusuf, or we say Yusuf, or Yusuf. His name is not Yusuf. His name is not Yusuf. It's Yusuf. The Dhamma. Prophet Yusuf, alayhi salatu wasalam. Wa ala nabiyyina kadhalik. Right? So it says, O my sons, go and find out about Yusuf and his brother. His father's commanding them, go out and find out about Yusuf and his brother. Who was his brother in this ayah? Who was he talking about? Who? Benjamin. Ben Yamin. By the way, since he mentioned that, it's a side note for your benefit. It is highly disliked, and some ulama say it's even not permissible. Some ulama. But the majority of them say it's highly disliked for you to name your child Ben Yamin. Ben Yamin. Today, it's highly disliked. It's highly disliked. Some say it's not permissible because there are three categories of when you take in names. And one of the three categories is if the name is strictly, more exclusively used by the Jews or the Christians. So that's a side note for you. So the meaning of the verse is, O my sons, go and find out about Yusuf and his brothers and despair not from the relief, despair not of relief from Allah. The shahid, the point in this ayah is, Fatahassasu. Fatahassasu. Go out and find, meaning get information. Get information about Yusuf alayhi salam and his brother. So that's for the verse, that's for the word tahassasu. Tahassasu min Yusuf min awakhi, min at-tahassus, wa huwa talabul khabar. That is to seek information. Amma at-tajassus. As for the other one with the jeem, not the ha, with the jeem, فَنَّهَا اللَّهُ جَلَّ وَعَلَىٰ عَنْهُ. Allah has prohibited this one. This is tajassus, with the seen. The spelling of it is ta, jim, seen, seen. The other one is ta, ha, seen, seen. Not what's called, seen. Tajassus. Tajassasa, yatajassasu, tajassus. Right? So tajassus is not like tahassus. Tajassus is prohibited. Allah says, وَلَا تَجَسَّسُوا وَلَا يَغْتَبْ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا. And do not make tajassus nor backbite one another. Tajassus is spying. This is spying. This is spying. Right? This is not permissible. The Shaykh says, التحسس بالعين تبدأوا تنظروا. He says that التجسس is with the eye. So you are looking, right? You're looking, investigating, trying to find out. You start out looking for something, right? رأيته يسير بمسير فتنظر إليه وتتبعوا حتى تعرف خبره. So now what you're doing is you're going out investigating, like, you know, like you're the FBI or like you're the CIA or like you're Interpol or, you know, or any of those other countries. I can't remember the names in Canada and Germany and UK, you know, MI3 or whatever. I don't remember, right? I don't know what the one in Trinidad and Guyana is called. What are they called in Guyana? Huh? CID. That's right. CID. You know, you're going out like you're CID. You're going to inspect the brother. You follow him. I'm tailing him now. You know, you're in the car. You're driving like a detective. And you're just looking for things. You're looking for something. We used to call this back in the 90s the vulture culture amongst the Muslims. The vulture culture. You're just waiting for your brother to be destroyed so you can just go and just get the meat, the last piece of meat off his bones. Just hoeing around him, checking him out, you know. Yeah, let me see what I can catch on him now. Twitter, I can tweet it. Instagram, I caught him on it. YouTube, I'm going to instantly see, let the whole world, the Muslims in Japan, Osaka, Japan, they know what the brother did now in the parking lot of White Castle. Allahumma sta'in wa alayhi tuklan. Naam. Eating haram chicken, right. So the Shaykh says, At-tajassus bil-ayn. So you start looking, it's with the eye. He says, La ihmadillah jalla wa ala an la tara min akhika illa khayr. He said, you're not praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you didn't see anything good from him. You don't want to see something good from him. Why do you want to see something? Why do you want to see your brother in a bad situation? He says, كَذَلِكَ التَّحَسُّسْ مَا إِخْبَارٌ فُلَانٌ. He says, and التَّحَسُّسْ, this is looking for information about a person. He says, where is he going? What is he doing? Why is he there? What is this? And this is bainaka wa bainahum khulla. You have this thing between you and your brother. It's a special brother. Wa bainaka wa bainahum. Wafa'un wa sahba. He says, فَلَا تُحَسِّسْ فِي أَخْبَارِهِ. Don't probe and investigate into his information. وَلَا تُجَسِّسُ عَلَيْهِ. And don't spy on him. How many people have stood next to the imam's office when he's in a meeting? Or the administration's office of the masjid? Or has stood next to their employer's office when the door is closed and they're listening? Or somebody doesn't know that you are on the other end of the phone and you're listening. This is tajassus. Now tajassus has gone beyond the eye now. Because technology has allowed people to do things with the ear that you could not do 1,000 years ago or 2,000 years ago or 3,000 years ago. So the sheikh, he's saying, فَلَا تُحَسِّسُوا فِي أَخْبَارِهِ. Don't probe and look for information. وَلَا تُجَسِّسُوا عَلَيْهِ. And don't spy on him. فَإِنَّ ذَلِكَ مَنْهِيٌ عَنْهُ الْمُسْلِمُ مَعْ إِخْوَانِهِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ بِعَامَ فَكَيْفَ بِمَنْ لَهُ مَعَهُ عَقْدٌ أُخْوَةٍ خَاصَةٌ. He says, so because this is prohibited for the Muslim to do this with his brother Muslims in general. So how much more? فَكَيْفَ بِمَنْ لَهُ مَعَهُمْ عَقْدٌ أُخُوَةٌ. But so then how much more, the Sheikh is saying, من باب الأولى, how much more when you have a special relationship with that brother and your special brotherhood? لا تحسسوا يعني لا تتبعوا تتبعوا أخبار إخوانك. Don't لا تحسسوا, meaning don't follow up and investigate. Don't probe. Don't probe and investigate and follow up like a detective on the information of your brother. ولا تتجسسوا يعني, and don't spy. لا تذهبوا بعينك. Don't be looking. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, if a person looks in somebody's house, they look through their house, their window or something like that, they look in, he said, that person on the inside has the right to take something sharp and stick it in their eye. This is what he said sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you look in the Quran, brothers, you see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned two types of awrah. We're usually only familiar with one type of awrah. Usually. If I ask the average Muslim sitting here right now, if I ask you, what is the awrah? You'll say, and of course there's some difference of opinion amongst the fuqaha, you'll say for the man, it's between the navel and the knee. For the woman, it's everything, but her hands and her face. And then some of the scholars say, of course, no, it's everything. The face has to be covered, the hands have to be covered. That we're not here to discuss that. But if the point is that if we were to say awrah, that's the first probably, and the only thing that's going to come to our mind, right? Is that true, brothers? Do you know of a second one? No. There's a second one mentioned in the Quran. The second awrah that's mentioned in the Quran is your bait. Your bait, your manzil. Your house in the Quran is called an awrah. It's called an awrah. Why? It's because it's also that thing that covers you. Because you can walk around the way you want to walk around. Of course, you have to be shy in front of Allah, right? You have to be shy in front of Allah, but still you're going to walk around in your house and do things in your house that you normally wouldn't do or wear and behave outside. So Allah calls your house in Surah Nur an awrah. That's why the kids in the house, when they reach a certain age, they can't come to you in your wife's room. Except for three occasions, they have to be turned away. Allah mentions it. The time early in the morning, as zahira, and in the afternoon, and at night when people are ready to go to bed. The kids can't come, they have to ask for permission. They can't just walk in, except for the little ones that don't know anything, like Hasanuddin, you know, like the little ones, right? It's the little ones that are running all around and using my iPhone. They don't know what's going on. They don't, you know, the pen is lifted from them. But the ones who the pen is not lifted, there's certain times that they can't come. into your room with you and your wife, because those are the private times. So your house is an awrah. So the sheikh, he says, Hafizahullah, he says, so you don't probe, you don't look for things. He says, you don't tanzuru ماذا فعل وماذا فعل فإن هذا من المنهي عنه وهو من المحرمات وهو من المحرمات. He says, so you're looking, what did he do here? What did he do there? Why did he do this? What is he doing here? Why? Let me follow him and see what he's doing. Like you're some policeman. You're the Muslim police. Right? All of this is prohibited. All of this is prohibited and it is unlawful. الحق الرابع من الحقوق أن تجنب أخاك سوء الظن به. The fourth right. From the rights of brotherhood, of al-ukhuwa, is that you stay far away from having bad thoughts about your brother and your sister in Islam. Don't have su'zan bihi or biha. Don't have su'zan. Don't have bad thoughts. The Shaykh says, لِأَنَّ سُوءَ الظَّنِّ بِهِ مُخَالِفٌ لِمَا تَقْتَدِيهِ الْأُخُوَّةِ. He says, because having bad thoughts, and these are two more vocabulary words now. We have husnul dhan. A lot of us know about this word. Husnul dhan. But we have the opposite, which is su'ul dhan. Husnul dhan is good thoughts. Good thoughts about your brother. And you also should have, you should not have su'ul dhan. Bad thoughts. He said, because this is a violation of what necessitates the brotherhood. The brotherhood is that you have good thoughts about your Muslim brother. He says, مقتضى الأخوة أن يكون الأخ لأخيه فيه الصدق والصلاح والطاعة. He says, because the brotherhood, it naturally brings about, it naturally necessitates that you have for your brother, or your brother has with you, siddiq, trustworthiness, truthfulness, veracity, that you're truthful, and salah, and goodness, and ta'ah, and obedience, has an asl fil Muslim. This is the foundational basis of the Muslim. Truthfulness, honesty, integrity, obedience, correction. He says, الأصل في المسلم أنه مطيع لله جل وعلا. That the أصل of a Muslim is that he's obedient to Allah. فإذا كان من إخوانك الخاصة فإنها يكون ثم حقا. He says, so if you have a special relationship with your brother, a close relationship with your sister, then that's going to bring two rights. Not one anymore. It's going to be حقاني. Two rights. حق عام له وحق خاص بأن, he said, تجتنبه سوء الظن. He says, the first one is a general right. The second one is a specific right that you stay far away from سوء الظن, having bad thoughts. وأن تحترس أنت من سوء الظن. That you guard and protect, staying away, far, far away, you from having su'al dhan, bad thoughts. Wallahu jalla wa ala naha an al dhan, because Allah has prohibited having suspicion. Su'al dhan is bad thoughts, suspicion. Allah has prohibited suspicion. Faqala subhana, ijtanibu kathiran min al dhanni fa inna ba'd al dhan ithmun. Avoid much assumption and suspicion. That means negative suspicion. Negative assumption. Indeed, some assumption or some suspicion is sin. I remember years ago, over 30 some years ago, close to 40, when I became Muslim, I surrendered to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I used to hang out with the Sufis. I used to hang out sometimes with the Jamaat al-Tabligh, right? And, you know, we know that they have major problems in Aqidah. major, super duper major problems in the Aqeedah. Because like Sheikh Al-Albani rahimahullah says that the Jamaat al-Tabligh are the people of, they're the Sufis of today. Right? And we don't want to go into a long discourse about that, but anybody wants to discuss that later, we can discuss that. If you have a misunderstanding or you think that what we're saying is unjustified, it is truly justified. They are a major fitna in the earth. But there are some things that they used to say. I used to listen to some of the things they would say in my early days of Islam, and they had some nice things, because everything, you know, even Iblis says the truth sometimes, right? And one of the things they used to say was from one of the imams of the Salaf, which is that that al-dhan ghibatul qalb. Al-dhan, meaning ahyanan, al-dhan ghibatul qalb. That suspicion is the backbiting of the heart. Suspicion is the backbiting of the heart. All right? So the Sheikh, he says, قال العلماء على قوله جل وعلا اجتنبوا كثيرا من الظن إن بعض الظن إثم. Avoid much negative suspicion, negative assumption. Indeed, some suspicion is a sin. Some of the علماء, they say, أن الظن منه ما هو مذموم ومنه ما هو محمود. There is some assumption or suspicion that is praiseworthy, or excuse, blameworthy, and there's some that is praiseworthy. We're going to end it here, inshallah, make these last two statements. I think they have to call the adhan. فَمَا كَانَ مِنَ الظَّنِّ مَحْمُودًا هُوَ مَا كَانَ مِنْ قَبِيلٍ مِنْ قَبِيلِ الْأَمَارَاتِ وَالْقَرَائِنِ الَّتِي هِيَ عِنْدَ الْقُضَاةِ وَعِنْدَ أَهْلِ الْإِصْلَاحِ وَأَهْلِ الْخَيْرِ الَّذِي يُرِيدُ نَصِيحَةً أَوْ يُرِيدُ إِقَامَةَ الْقَرَائِنِ وَالدَّلَائِلِ عِنْدَ الْقَاضِي فالقاضي يقيم الحجة ويطلب البينة وكثير منها قائم في مقام الظنون لكن هنا يجب أن يأخذ بها فالاجتناب لكثير من الظن فهذا الظن هو أن تظن بأخيك سوءا أن تظن بأخيك شرا وقد قال عليه الصلاة والسلام إياكم والظن. Translated, and then inshallah we'll stop. The Sheikh, he says, so this one, this assumption and this suspicion, some of it is blameworthy and some of it is praiseworthy. Some of it is blameworthy and some of it is praiseworthy. He says, فَمَا كَانَ مِنَ الظَّنِّ مَحْمُودًا. So that which is from the assumption or the suspicion that is praiseworthy, he says, then this is from amongst those indicators and signs and extenuating evidences, al-qara'in, extenuating evidences of which are utilized by judges, like in courts. Those extenuating evidences that are utilized by judges, by the people who are going to make reconciliation amongst people, by the people of goodness, etc. You see, Ahlul Khair means people of goodness, but it means the people here who are either going to rectify the affairs in the community or the people who have money. Allah has blessed them with wealth. It could be them also. Who are they going to dispense the money? So they have to have some thoughts about certain people before they give their money, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't tell us. In fact, He tells us to not give our money to the sufaha. This is in the Quran. Don't give your wealth to the sufaha, the people who are reckless with their money, the people who don't know what to do with money. They have bad business acumen, or they use drugs, or they're just wasteful, or whatever. Don't give your money to the sufaha. That's what Allah says. So the Sheikh, he says, so this praiseworthy dhan, this praiseworthy suspicion or assumption, is when somebody desires to give nasiha, desires to give advice, or to establish some type of proof or judgment with some evidences that a judge is going to use. He wants to establish a proof against someone, and he's seeking for clarification for something. He said, so when someone does this, and it necessitates sometimes having some thoughts. Now, what was his intention for doing this? What was her motive for doing this? Like this, He said, so in general, we stay away from it because in most cases, it's bad. In most cases, having these thoughts are bad. He says, وَهَذَا الظَّنْ هُوَ أَن تَظُنَّ بِأَخِيكَ سُوءٍ. And this is the one, the assumption or the suspicion that you have bad about your brother. That you have bad thoughts about your brother. You have evil thoughts about your brother. And that's why the Prophet, and we're going to end it here, said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, until after the adhan, إِيَّاكُمْ وَالظَّنْ. And I learned from one of my teachers years ago, رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى, that إِيَّاكُمْ وَالظَّنْ, beware of suspicion, has two sides. And it was beautiful when he explained, SubhanAllah, I never would have seen it this way. We thank Allah for the ulama. He said, the first one, everybody knows, beware of suspicion. إِيَّاكُمْ وَالظَّنْ, beware of suspicion, meaning beware of being suspicious of others. But he said the other side of إِيَّاكُمْ وَالظَّنْ, beware of suspicion, is drawing suspicion to yourself. Putting yourself in a situation that makes people suspicious of you. That's the other side we don't follow. We're quick to follow the first part, not be suspicious. But now you shouldn't put yourself in a situation where you draw one to yourself. You see? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did that. He was in i'tikaf. He was walking his wife back to the house. Two Ansari men were coming down the other side of the road. And what did he say? He said, this is my wife. Right? What did he do? He removed what? Suspicion from himself. Oh, Messenger of Allah, we would never think. Nope. No. We would never think you, Messenger. No. This is my wife. Right? This is my wife. So if a brother's walking down the street, maybe the brother, he got married a second time. The brothers in the community don't know about it because he wanted to keep the esrar. He wanted to keep those secrets to himself until his wife can be comfortable with it. Right? His wife knew, but the brothers didn't know. So the brothers see him sitting in the coffee shop with the sister, right in her face, and he's holding her hand, he's rubbing her hand, you know, mashallah. Right? And the brother said, I know he doesn't have any daughters. I know that can't be his mother. Right? That cannot be his mother. Right? Maybe it's his aunt, maybe it's his sister. Yeah, start having bad thoughts. It's the brother's new wife. Allahu Akbar, it's the brother's new wife. So the Shaykh said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, إِيَّاكَ وَظَنْ. He says, فَهَذَا عَامٌ. That's in general. He says, ظَنُّ مِنْ جِيَةِ الْأَقْوَالِ. You have a suspicion or assumption from statements. وَنَهَا عَنَ الظَّنْ مِنْ جِيَةِ الْأَفْعَالِ. And then you have a prohibition of thoughts, suspicion, and assumption from actions. فَإِنَّ الظَّنْ أَكْذَبُ الْحَدِيثِ. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he talked about dhann with statements and dhann with actions. Suspicion with statements, assumption with statements, and assumption with actions. That, he said, فَإِنَّ الظَّنْ أَكْذَبُ الْحَدِيثِ. He said that indeed a dhann, the suspicion, is the most lying of conversations. He said, هَذَا نَصُّهُ عَلَيْهِ صَلَاتُ وَسَلَامُ. الظن هو أكذب ما يكون في قلبك. He says, suspicion is the most lying type of speech that can be in your heart. Like we said, that suspicion is the backbiting of the heart. It is the backbiting of the heart. فَإِنَّ الظن أكذب الحديث إذا حدثتك إذا حدثتك نفسك من داخلك بالظنون فاعلم أن هذا هو أكذب الحديث. He says, so it is the most lying of speeches. So anytime your soul whispers to you, your nafs speaks to you from inside of yourself to have these bad thoughts, he said, then you should know that that is the most lying of speech. Why? It's because the tongue, the heart also has a tongue. The heart has a tongue too. It's just not this one. You can be totally silent and your heart is thinking. Your heart is speaking to you. Your soul is whispering to your heart, yeah, I know what it is. Yeah, see, I thought it all the time. I knew it. See there? So the Sheikh says, إِذَنْ حَقُّ أَخِيكَ عَلَيْكَ أَنْ لَا تَظُنَّ بِهِ إِلَّا خَيْرٍ. So it is upon you as a right for your brother. And I apologize, I said it 2-3 times now. This is, we're ending it. That you do not have thoughts, assumptions about your brother except خَيْر. وَأَنْ تَجْتَنِبَ مَعَهُ الظَّنَّ السَّيِّئَ. And you stay far away from having the dhan that is sayyid, the evil thoughts. كَمَا أَمَرَكَ اللَّهُ جَلَّ وَعَلَى بِذَلِكَ بِقَوْلِهِ اجْتَنِبُوا كَثِيرًا مِنَ الظَّنِّ إِنَّ بَعْضَ الظَّنِّ إِثْمٌ. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah jalla wa ala has ordered you and I avoid much negative assumption. Indeed, some assumption is sin. هذا صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. سبحانه وحمده أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك. So the Sheikh, he says, فَالظَّنُّ سَيِّئٌ إِثْمٌ عَلَى صَاحِبِهِ يَأْثَمُ بِهِ لِأَنَّهُ خَالَفَ الْأَصْلِ. He says, so the bad assumptions and thought is a sin on the person who has it. He has caused himself to commit sin because he is opposing the asl, the foundation. What's the foundation? Is that the Muslim is somebody who is truthful. The Muslim is somebody who is honest. The Muslim is someone who has integrity. Even though we know that's not the foundation of a human being, but once the person accepts Islam, we assign to him al-adala. We assign to him, once he accepts Islam, we assign to him al-adala. Al-adala is integrity, uprightness, correctness. وَقَدْ رَوَى الْإِمَامُ أَحْمَدُ فِي الزُّهْدِ وَرَوَاهُ غَيْرُهُ أَنَّ عُمَرَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهُ قَالَ نَاسِحًا لَا تَظُنَّنَّ بِكَلِمَةٍ خَرَجَتْ مِنْ أَخِيكَ سُوءًا وَأَنْتَ تَجِدُ لَهَا فِي الْخَيْرِ مَحْمَلًا. He said that Umar ibn al-Khattab رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهُ, in a narration that's collected by Imam Ahmad and others, that Umar, giving advice, said, do not think of a word that comes from your brother to be evil, while at the same time you could find something of good, how it could have been conveyed or understood. We'll say it again. Do not have an assumption about what your brother has come, that emits from your brother, to be evil. He said, for you, while at the same time you could, وَأَنْتَ تَجِدُ لَهَا فِي الْخَيْرِ مَحْمَلًا, while you could have given it another understanding of something for good. What that means is, the Sheikh says, لاحظ أنه نهى عن الظن السيء في الأقوال ما دام أن الكلام يحتمل الصواب يحتمل الخير فلا تظنن السوء بأخيك. He says, pay close attention. It is prohibited to have bad thoughts with regards to statements. He says, as long as the statement could have another meaning. As long as the statement could have on one side of it something that's correct. You hear your brother say something, in other words, you take the part that is, it's plausible. There's something that is on another side of it, it could mean something good. He says, لَا يَقُولُ الْبَاطِلُ. Don't, and I'm saying, I'm putting the word in here because this is the meaning with the Sheikh, and Allah knows best what the Sheikh means. But I believe what he means here when he says, لَا يَقُولُ الْبَاطِلُ. Don't be quick to say it's false. Don't be quick to say that it's wrong. He says, فَإِذَا كَانَ الْكَلَمْ يَحْتَمِلُ صَوَابٌ فَوَجِّهُهُ إِلَى الصَّوَابٌ He says, so if the speech, meaning that's coming from the brother, has another side to it that could have another meaning to it, then you should always go to that part of it that is correct. He says, فَيَسْلِمْ أَخُوكَ مِنَ النَّقْدِ وَيَسْلِمُ مِنَ الظَّنِّ السَّيِّئِ He said, and by doing this, your brother in Islam will be safe from criticism. Your brother in Islam will be saved and secure from evil thoughts. وَتَسْلِمُ أَنْتَ مِنَ الْإِثْمِ And you'll be saved from sin. You'll be saved from sin. وَأَيْضًا يَسْلِمُ مِنَ التَّأَثُّرِ He says, likewise, he will be saved from being impacted and affected. He says, تَسْلِمُ وَيَسْلِمُ هُوَ مَنْ أَنْ يَتَأَثَّرْ بِهِ وَيُقْتَدَى بِهِ He says also, you will be saved and you'll be on the safe side and he'll be on the safe side. You'll be in a state of security and he'll be in a state of security from being impacted and being followed. In that thing. He says, لِهَذَا قَالَ
عَبْدُ اللَّهِ بْنُ مُبَارَكَ الْإِمَامُ الْمُجَاهِدَ الْمَعْرُوفِ
He says, and for that reason, عَبْدُ اللَّهِ بْنُ مُبَارَكَ الْإِمَامُ الْمُجَاهِدُ who is well known, he said, الْمُؤْمِنُ يَطْلُبُ الْمَعَاذِيرُ الْمُؤْمِنُ يَطْلُبُ الْمَعَاذِيرُ He said, Abdullah ibn Mubarak said, that the believer, he searches and seeks out for excuses. The believer searches out for excuses. He says, يَلْتَمِسُ الْمَعْذِرَةِ He's always looking for a way out for his brother or sister in Islam, an excuse, a ma'zira. He says, لِأَنَّ الْأَحْوَالِ كَثِيرًا Because conditions and circumstances are many. وَالشَّيْطَانُ يَأْتِي لِلْمُسْلِمِ يُحَدِّدُ الْحَالِ Brothers, I know we don't have a lot of time. We have the time for the salat. This is really, really important. I usually don't try to go this long, but these points that the Sheikh is about to make right now, I'm asking permission. Where's Rafiq? I'm asking permission to go another 10 minutes. I know it's time. We have 15 minutes. This is an extremely important point. Everything the Sheikh has been saying for the past few weeks is extremely important. But these points are very, very, very important. Especially in our times of Twitter and Facebook and the technology and internet technology. All of these things. Listen closely. The Sheikh says, لِأَنَّ الْأَحْوَالَ كَثِيرًا Because circumstances, meaning the circumstances of people, are many. He says, وَالشَّيْطَانُ يَأْتِي لِلْمُسْلِمِ فَيُحَدِّدُ الْحَالَ This is serious. He says, because Shaitan, he will come to the Muslim and he will restrict that person's circumstance. Listen to what he's saying. He says, معنى الكلمة بشيء واحد حتى يوقع العداوة والبغضاء. He says, يحدد معنى الكلمة بشيء واحد حتى يوقع العداوة والبغضاء. He says, Shaytan, when your brother is in a certain circumstance, you see that sister in a certain circumstance, and you know them to be upright. You know them to be trustworthy. You know them to be clean Muslims. For years they've been worshiping Allah. You've been knowing them for years to fear Allah. He says, Shaytan yatika wa yuhaddid laka wa yuhaddid laka al-hala. Halatahu wa halataha. Shaytan will come and make you restrict what they're saying or they're doing to just one explanation. It can't be anything else. It's just one, right? And then with that one, it causes between you and him enmity and hatred.
إنما يريد الشيطان أن يوقع بينكم العداوة والبغضاء في الخمر والميسر ويصدكم عن ذكر الله وعن الصلاة فهل أنتم منتهون. Satan, Allah says, the meaning of it is, the meaning of what we just read, what Allah says, Satan only wants to cause between you animosity and hatred through intoxicants and gambling, and to avert you from the remembrance of Allah and from prayer. So will you not desist. Listen to what the Sheikh says. He's giving us a serious benefit. الشيطان يحدد لك أن تفسير هذه الحالة هو كذا فقط. أن تفسير هذه المقالة هو كذا فقط. حتى تكون ظنا سيئا فتؤثم. وحتى يكون بينك وبين أخيك النفرة وعدم الائتلاف. وهناك أصل من الأصول في فهم الكلام وهو أن لكل كلام دلالة. وهو أن لكل كلام دلالة. دلالة الكلام عند الأصوليين متنوعة. ومن دلالته ما يسمى يعني عند العلماء الأصول الفقه متخصصين في الأصول الفقه الدلالة الحملية. Listen to what the Sheikh says. Shaitan will limit and restrict for you the explanation of that brother or that sister's circumstances. He says that it can only be this. The only reason why he's doing this right now is this. Shaitan will come to you. It can't mean anything else but this. He's using drugs. But the reality could be is that he didn't tell you that he has leukemia and he's getting morphine treatments. Shaitan is telling you, no, he's a dope addict. It can't be anything else. The Sheikh says, أن تفسير هذه المقالة and the statement, Shaitan will come and restrict for you the explanation of his statement that it can't be anything except the meaning of it is this. He said, until you have bad thoughts and now you become a sinner. And so now between you and your brother, there is alienation. There is separation. There is a fissure. There is a breakup. There is a fracture. You become disconnected. There's no more unity. There's nothing but discord. He says, وَهُنَاكَ and there's a principle from amongst the principles, specifically from the scholars of Usul. It is called الدلالة الحملية. The only way I can translate this is الدلالة الحملية is contextual interpretation. The Sheikh says, what is it? He says, الدلالة الحملية يعني دلالة السياق على الكلام. هناك كلام إذا أخذ بمفرده دل على شيء، ولكن إذا أخذ بسياقه يعني سباقه ولحاقه بما قبله وبما بعده أوضح المراد. The Sheikh says, this thing called الدلالة الحملية are the things that happen contextually from speech. It's used in Usul al-Fiqh by the scholars, but he's using it here for the issues of brotherhood, right? In other words, if a statement was taken singularly by itself, then it's going to indicate one thing. He said, but if it's taken contextually when you know what is said before it and what is said after it, then the true intent and objective of the person that said it becomes clear. So somebody said, you know what he said? He said such and such. Yeah, but what did you say before he said such and such that made him so angry that he said what he said? And you take that and you tweeted it on Twitter, but didn't tell the people that you said, I hate you, you a black man, I don't like Africans, I don't, you a Punjabi, I'm a Muhajir, You didn't tell him what was said before, and you didn't tell him what was said after. You only told him what that one thing was said in that one part. CNN and Fox News do it all the time. Don't they? They do it all the time. The journalists do it all the time. They give you sound bites, right? They give you pieces of information. But what was said before that? What was said after that? What were the entire circumstances? That's why Abdullah ibn Mubarak said, Al-Mu'minu yatlubu al-ma'azir, that the believer looks for excuses. Look, brothers, we have the hadith collected by Imam Abu Dawood in his Sunan. The hadith is on the authority of Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that said, جاءت امرأة إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. A woman came to the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم. She said, Ya Rasulullah, Zawji Safwan ibn al-Mu'attal yadribuni idha sallaytu wa yufattiruni idha sumtu wa la yusalli salat al-fajri hatta tatlu' al-shams. To the end of the hadith. Sahih hadith. This woman came to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She complained to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about her husband, and his name was mentioned, and he was standing there. His name was mentioned. Right now, in the books of hadith, his name is going to be there until Yawm al-Qiyamah. You're going to know exactly who he is. His name was Safwan ibn al-Mu'attal, radiyallahu anhu. She said, my husband beats me when I pray. He makes me break my fast. And he doesn't pray Fajr until after the sun has risen. Right? So, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam heard the side of the husband. The side of the husband. So, he asked her and he gave his side. Safwan ibn Mu'attal radiallahu anhu, he said, as for her statement, Messenger of Allah, يَضْرِبُنِي إِذَا صَلَّيْتُ, that he beats me when I pray. He said, she recites two surahs, and I have prohibited her from reciting two surahs. And meaning, she recites long surahs. Maybe Surah Nisa, maybe Surah Al-Baqarah, maybe Surah Ali Imran, maybe Surah Maidah. She recites two surahs, and I have prohibited her. فَقَدْ نَهَيْتُهُ عَنْهَا. فَقَدْ نَهَيْتُهَا عَنْهَا. I have prohibited her from making these two long surahs. The Prophet ﷺ said, if there was only one surah that would have been revealed, لَكَتَفَ النَّاسِ, it would have been sufficient for the people. He said, as for her statement, يُفَطِّرُنِي إِذَا سُمْتُ, as for her statement, he makes me break my fast. He said, Messenger of Allah, أَنَا شَاب فَلَا أَصْبِرُ تَنْتَلِقُ وَتَسُومْ وَأَنَا الشَّابْ فَلَهْ أَصْبِرْ. He says, oh, Messenger of Allah, I'm a young man. I can't be patient. She goes in fast. I can't be patient. The Prophet ﷺ said, لَا يَجُوزُ لِمْرَأَةٍ أَن تَسُومْ بِدُونِ إِذْنِ زَوْجِهَا. It's not permissible, meaning outside of Ramadan, for a woman to fast without the permission of her husband. Right? As for her statement, I don't pray until after the sun has risen, he says, you know, our people are known. My tribe and my family, our family, that tribe is known. He says, we work, meaning we work all the way up until right before Fajr, and then we go to sleep. We go to sleep because his family, his tribe, was known for going out to go get the water in Medina. In Al-Medina, when the people were sleeping, they used to go out to draw the water out of the wells to bring it back so the people can make wudu, they can make ghusl, they can wash up, they can cook, etc. So the Prophet ﷺ said, إِذَا اسْتَيْقَظْتَ فَصَلِّي. He says, so when you wake up, pray. Now, we only heard the side of his wife, what would we think? We would have bad thoughts about this man. Bad thoughts about this man. So the Sheikh, he says that this Ad-Dilalatul Hamliya is you look at what was said before and you look at what was said after, and then you put it into context. Because people have circumstances. I'll end it with this. The brother, it's December 24th, between quotes, Christmas Eve. The brother, Con Edison bill has to be paid. He has three small children, triplets, in the house, in the apartment. The lights are going to be cut off. He has to pay the bill. All the banks and everything are closed. But he can still cash his check. The only place he can cash his check so he can go pay the bill is the liquor store. That's the only place he can go cash his check. So he goes into the liquor store, and you see him coming out. You see him coming out. And then you not only tweet it, you take your nice iPhone 7, the new one, the one with the pixels that's 50 million zillion pixels and is, you know, got the best camera, Instagram, boom! And you shoot it up to everybody in the world and you put a tag on it. See, he even had his thaub on, his goofy, coming out of a liquor store. But you know the brother. For years, 15 years, you know this brother. Imam al-Shafi'i, rahimahullah, he said, حُسْنُ الظَّنْ لِحُسْنِ الْعَمَلِ وَسُوءِ الظَّنْ لِسُوءِ الْعَمَلِ. He said, good thoughts are for good actions, and bad thoughts are for bad actions. If you know the person to be a good person, why would you not put the best construction? Why would you not give it the best interpretation, the best mahmal, the best tafsir? Give him 1,000, 1,000,000 excuses. Give him an excuse, and give him another excuse, and give him another excuse, and give him another excuse. There come some times where you can't give those excuses. But in general, this is the way we have to be with the Muslims. We should not be thinking bad about the Muslims, because the Muslims are the people who worship Allah. Just like you, they believe in Allah in the last day, just like you. If you think bad about them, then who are you going to think good about? Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton? Who are you going to think good about? Who's going to be left if you think bad about all the Muslims? Allahumma sta'in wa alayhi tukman. Hadha wa sallallahu wa sallam wa barik ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. There's a question that the brother has on his phone. Says one more question, please, in reference to what the Sheikh is saying about the one's restrictions for the thoughts of his brother. Can this sometimes be a result of the person's own actions and their behavioral history? And it's possible. Absolutely, it can be possible, because sometimes a person will say something about somebody else, but in actuality, it's themselves who has the problem. So they try to put a cloud over the other person's head. And no, we don't understand sometimes, but we don't remember. We forget. Not don't remember. We forget that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ala kulli shay'in shaheed. Allah is a witness over everything. And then the last question, how can one preserve one's honor if they are causing fitna behind the scenes? For example, going around oppressing different people in the community outside of the masjid, but when in the masjid, they're on their best behavior. We should make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protects us from the harm of others. And if we find them truly causing this fitna, because there's a possibility that they may not be causing the fitna, but if they are the ones who are causing the fitna, then they should be advised. They should be advised. They should be advised. Because ad-deenu nasiha, qalu liman, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the religion is nasiha. And they said to who? He said, lillahi wa li kitabihi wa li rasulihi wa li a'immatil muslimin wa amatihim. That the advice is to Allah, to his book, to his messenger, to the leaders of the Muslims, and to the common folk. So we should give them advice and tell them to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanaka wa hamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.